Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Mrinmoy Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today we will discuss a module on Pakeha plays, and especially we'll discuss on Roger Hall, Glide Time. The author of this module is Shashwati Shaha, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Sikkim University. In this module, we will talk about what is Pakeha, and we will have a brief discussion about Pakeha plays, and we will introduce the Pakeha playwright Roger Hall, and there will be a brief discussion on dramatic practice of Roger Hall, and we will talk about the story of Glide Time and reception and responses of Glide Time, and then we will summarize the whole module. In this module, we will be learning what does the term Pakeha mean, how the essence of being a Pakeha is arrived through the relation with the indigenous Maori people of Atorio. We will see how the notion of being a Pakeha has undergone changes over the years, and that the identity of Pakeha and Maori is not on the basis of race or ethnicity, but on the basis of the history that they have shared being in Aotearoa. Then we will take a small tour through Pakeha theatre, culture, and we'll try to understand the kind of sensibilities that get depicted in the Pakeha plays. In their themes and performances, we will see how the Pakeha tries to inhabit this new place where they have arrived and make it their own. The module especially focuses on Roger Hall, a prominent playwright of New Zealand, and his most successful play, Glide Time, first staged in 1976. The module attempts a thematic reading and analysis of the play, placing it in the socio-political and economic condition of the New Zealand. Now let us talk about what is Pakeha. Any discussion on Pakeha literary genre is impossible without knowing what Pakeha means. A rough sketch of the Pakeha cultural identity is inevitable before beginning any discussion on Pakeha plays. Therefore, this section will try to understand the term Pakeha. Pakeha is a term used to denote the white New Zealanders, mainly comprising of the settlers from Europe. The first recorded use of the word Pakeha is in the Treaty of Waitangi. A Pakeha initially was a white man who came from England and settled and worked in New Zealand. Later, the term came to be used more generally to denote any fair-skinned person who was born in New Zealand. Mary Ellen O'Connor, 1990, defines Pakeha as the dominant white race in New Zealand. This would cover anybody of Anglo-Celtic origin like England, Scotland, Ireland, and Wales, and as the integrated Northern Europeans, Scandinavians, Germans, and Dutch, white American, Canadians, and South Africans. But in order to understand a Pakeha, one must also understand the term Maori, because a white New Zealander is a Pakeha only in relation to a Maori, or an indigenous Polynesian inhabitant of New Zealand. The term Maori was used by the indigenous population to describe them as different from the European settlers. But with time, the term got adopted by the Europeans to describe the indigenous people. But according to Living, Maoris of New Zealand, a Maori do not primarily use the term to describe themselves, but only use the tribe name, as they are essentially tribal people. A Maori is a Maori only in relation to Pakeha, thus denoting the linguistic, racial, ethnic and cultural difference between the indigenous people of Aotearoa and the European settlers. Michael King, in his books, Being Pakeha, 1985, defined Pakeha as denoting non-Maori New Zealanders. Some people consider Pakeha to be a derogatory term or an insult hurled at the fair-skinned people of non-Polynesian descent in New Zealand. According to them, the term Pakeha means long pig or white pig. Some New Zealanders of white descent are reluctant to call themselves Pakeha, also because the term originated in a language that is not their own. Such people prefer words like Caucasians or New Zealand European. But both these terms are problematic, since it covers a wide range of people, and second or third generation of settlers cannot be called European anymore. However, considerably early records dating back to the mid-19th century show the European missionaries and government officials also referred to themselves as Pakeha. The changing usage of the term Pakeha complicates the notion of ethnicity. If an ethnic group comprises of people who share common ancestry, culture and history, then Pakeha can never refer to an ethnic group as it comprises a mixed bag of fair-skinned people of different ethnic and racial origin. Therefore, the term Pakeha or Maori offer us a way to differentiate between the historical origins of settlers, the Polynesian and European. Pakeha, its origin and meaning by Jody Ranford. Jody Ranford commented this. Now, let us talk briefly about Pakeha plays. Pakeha plays mainly deal with the representation of Pakeha cultural identity on the stage or the expression of Pakeha culture in theatrical performances. For instance, Gary Henderson's play Homeland 2005 deals with Pakeha's sense of belonging to the country of New Zealand and their relationship to what they too now consider to be their homeland. The play talks about an old man, Ken, who is 80 years old and is reluctant to leave his farm, which he considers to his home and hence the basis of his power. These plays deal with the touching issue of the Pakeha being considered as the other and the outsider to the Maoris who are indigenous to the soil. Pakeha plays usually encapsulate the European theatre tradition on the one hand and the Pakeha experience of being a post-colonial people rooted in Aotearoa or New Zealand on the other. In most of these plays, the Pakeha people are seen as people moved away from their places of origin, changed by their living experience in Aotearoa and in search of a sense of belonging in their adopted land. Land featured as an important metaphorical character in many of the Pakeha plays. As Smith Avrian points out, one of the first ways of establishing a cultural identity within a new territory is to lay claim to the landscape, because turning space into place gives a people a tangible form of ownership to an area. The land is the focus of the cultural conflict between the Maori and the settlers. Some of the issues that Pakeha plays deal with are hybridity, biculturalism, and the problem of expressing the difference between Pakeha cultural identity and other Western cultural identities, distance and its relationship to Pakeha sensibility. And some of the most recognizable Pakeha characteristics. However, the problems faced by Pakeha theatre include the lack of local Pakeha language and that they work with imported concepts. They often take up concerns that are local and then improvise and reconfigure them inside the forms received from Europe. The Pakeha theatre has to deal with the cultural other, who is an intrinsic part of the culture of the land and against whom the Pakeha are represented both in the world and the world of theatre. In order to localize the plays and make them a part of Atoaroa, the Pakeha plays often make use of local themes and Maori iconography. It is for long that Pakeha theatre had been Eurocentric, and Europe had for long dominated the matter and structure of the plays. Pakeha theatre, as it were, was speaking through Europe. It represented an European worldview. What differentiates Pakeha theatre from that of the European theatrical performances is the theme, and one of the major themes is how the Pakeha tries to connect to the new land and establish a relationship with it. Thus, Pakeha theatre moves gradually from complete rejection of the Maori as alien to integrating some of their otherness of the Maori and coming to terms with the other quality of the land. Roger Hall was born on 17th January 1939 in Essex, England. He received his education from London University College School and then began his career in insurance. He emigrated to New Zealand in 1957 and therefore qualifies as a very recent fair-skinned Pakeha in Aotearoa. In New Zealand too, Hall continued with his work in insurance and performed in amateur theatre in Wellington. He began his playwriting career with writing plays for school children. He became a naturalized New Zealander in 1980. Hall soon became the most famous playwright of New Zealand, as none of the plays written by him went unstaged. His plays always filled houses. No wonder his autobiography is titled Bums on Seats, 1998. The Oxford Companion to New Zealand Literature states that a desire to write and to act was kindled by his father's talent as an impersonator. Frequent family visits to the theatre, especially reviews, and by his love of post-war British radio comedies such as Itma and Hancock's Half Hour. But the opportunity to do both came only after Hall moved to New Zealand. Hall is known for his sense of humor that runs through all his plays. But even if audience chuckles at the comedy that pervades the surface of the play, the deep social criticism and the feelings of pathos never goes unnoticed. His plays have also traveled far and wide and have been performed at various international venues. Hall has also scripted for films and television. Hall's career as a playwright began in the 1970s, and since then he has written 27 plays and had been equally successful for 3 decades continuously, which is a phenomenal achievement. Hall's best known work in New Zealand so far is Glide Time, first performed in the year 1976. It was his breakthrough piece of work which set the pattern of most of Hall's works. In 1977 came his most internationally known play, Middle-Aged Spread, which was later made into a film and a successful West End production. In 1977, he was a Burns Fellow at Dunedin. Here, he conducted a writing workshop. Later, he accounted the difficulties he had faced during this workshop and wrote State of the Play, which is a play about playwriting. Although this piece of work had been one of his favorites, yet it had not gained much commercial success after its premiere at Wellington Downstage Theatre in 1978. The Share Club was written in 1987, before the stock market crash and in 1988 came after the crash. 1991 saw another most famous work by Roger Hall, Conjugal Rights. It was a melancholy stage sitcom which was made into a television series for Britain's Granada Television. His market forces came in 1995. According to the Oxford Companion to New Zealand Literature, in the lighter market forces, Hall tests the old maxim that the more things change, the more they stay the same, depicting the characters of glide time and gliding on in the environment of the restructured public service. Roger Hall wrote two plays for all female casts, Social Climbers 1995 and By Degrees 1993. His another big-time stage hit was Come On Black, a solo play about a rugby supporter on tour in South Africa, which captured pathos and political and social comments with comedy, very characteristics of Hall. Before the turn of the century, Hall wrote three further plays, Dynamite, 1996, The Blue Club, 1999, and You Gotta Be Joking, 1999. Hall then took up retellings of traditional fairy tales with Aladdin 2006 and Jack and the Beanstalk 2007. Hall wrote two plays in 2007, Who Wants to Be a Hundred, Anyone Who's 99, and Who Needs Sleep Anyway. Two further plays were released in 2009, Dick Whittington and His Cat, and Four Flat Whites in Italy. Shortcut to Happiness was released in 2011, described by the Auckland Theatre Company, as quoted in Oxford Companion to New Zealand Literature as, Roger Hall is back to delight us once again. There is a clash of cultures and prejudices as a group of laid-back North Shore retirees confront the strict discipline of a Russian folk dancing class. This is classic Hall, incisive, funny, and full of compassion. You can always hand them back with songs by British composer Peter Skellern, was released in 2012. It had the usual humor, but the underlying remorse. In 2016, 40 years on from the production of Glide Time, Hall wrote Last Legs. Oxford Companion to New Zealand Literature says it is set in an upmarket retirement home. Well-to-do, seniors in Hall's play indulge in greed, jealousy, love and lust, alongside gossip, backstabbing and scandal. It played to packed houses and following Glide Time had to have a written season. He was also selected for the 1982 Fulbright Travel Fellowship to the United States. Hall was awarded 1986 Tarnovsky Prize for Outstanding Contribution to the Arts, was honored as Companion of the Queen's Service Order for Community Service in 1987. Hall was awarded a New Zealand 1990 Commemoration Medal. Hall was awarded a 2002 Toastmaster International Communicator and Leadership Award, and in 2003 was honored as a Companion of the New Zealand Order of Merit CNZM for his services as a playwright. Roger Hall was a visiting Fulbright professor in Georgetown University, Washington, D.C. in 2003. In 2011, Hall was awarded two Lifetime Achievement Awards, one at the Hackman Awards, Auckland, and another at the Dunedin Theatre Awards. In 2014, Hall was presented a scroll of honor from the Variety Artists Club of New Zealand for a lifetime of excellence in the performing arts. Hall received a 2015 Prime Minister's Award for Literary Achievement. Now, let us discuss briefly about the dramatic practice of Roger Hall. Roger Hall has majorly focused on the angst and exacerbations of the middle class. In an interview given to Gilbert Wong for New Zealand Herald, Hall says, I do seem to have a sense of what is happening in the middle class. Social change is what interests me most. It fascinates me and I like documenting it. In a way, I am always laughing at myself. Hall always seemed to be critical about the middle class point of view of life. Middle class is the monotonous state of being that is mostly safe, unexciting, and predictable. Hall can only see the contradiction. We were so snobbishly obsessed what we should not have a class system, and yet it's getting more ingrained. He recalls his character Rig in Middle Age spread complaining that middle class had become a term of abuse. Rig laments that all he wants to do is work ahead and bring up his kids right. Hall captures all of these and many more of the middle class with a blend of humor and sadness. The small gains and the bigger loss that a middle class man or woman goes through, and the painful process through which they try to compose themselves, form the core of his works. While Hall's plays are funny, their comedy is that of sorrowful resilience, like Chekhov's, and of serious and social criticism, for all their unfashionable willingness to treat the middle class with some sympathy. His one-liners can show truth about human manners as well as wit. His characters have sometimes been dismissed as stereotypes, and his female characters have provoked particular criticism. Glide Time set the pattern of most of Hall's work, a series of gently satirical sketches linked by running gags and the gradual revelation of the characters' generally dismal predicaments. The blend of comedy and pathos probably owes much to Tommy Hancock, though Alan Eichhorn is often cited, as is Chekhov, to whom Hall paid tribute in A Dream of Sussex Towns, 1986. Glide Time. Glide Time was written during 1970, when Wellington was a city full of public servants in several departments. Hall struck a chord in the minds of the city people by encapsulating the ethos of the life of such mundane middle class, who were mostly public servants. To be a public servant in the 1970s was not difficult, because there were far more government departments then. This was the time when people stuck to a single job for their entire lifetime, no matter how bad it was or how bad they were at it. People aspired to be a part of the PSIS, or the Public Service Investment Society, which allowed them to get loans and 12.5% discount at the retail stores. The official working hour was 7 hours 35 minutes with a full hour of lunch break. The Friday night was only happy because there would be no official work till Monday. The weekend included work in and around home. As such, there was not much happening in the lives of an average middle class man. The play captures the sentiment of the middle class life of the 70s, much before the face of public service changed. In his essay titled Hallmarked, Roger Hall's Three Comedies, Ian Fraser remarks, "Hall is engaged not in subverting but in asserting the values of the middle class. Life in the Glide Time office is conditioned by bureaucratic inertia and arbitrary regulation. But in the face of this daily absurdity, Hall seems to suggest that a redeeming comradeship and compassion are possible." Unquote. Glide Time is a play on the lives of the members of the stores section of a large government department. It points out the barrenness and wastefulness of such a life, which is nothing but a long-standing wait for superannuation, a preparation for a short retired life and the impending death. To pass time, there are somewhat dull inter or extra office affairs, small diversions like passion for rugby, but a thread of monotony runs throughout the play. The lives of almost all the characters are blighted. The very title of the play suggests a kind of government lethargy. There seem to be large government bureaucracies with employees who kept time off their working hours, arranging in the way it suited them the most and not their clients. The play is set in a government office with four employees, John, Jim, Hug, and Beryl, and one boss. There is another staff member in the office named Max, but he is absent as he has broken his leg. But his desk appears on the stage. The play has ample examples of sloth and inefficiency in the public service departments, as the members are quite mindful of their break times. Never answer phone calls during lunch hours. Beryl speaks to her mother using office phone several times during duty hours, but never during lunch break. Max's share of work keeps pending, and no one takes responsibility of the piling overdue works. The drab existence of the middle-class life is emphasized by the appearance of the characters who can barely manage good clothes of themselves. The only character who seems to have some amount of energy is John, who is described as a man who worked hard and efficiently at his job, though pretends not to. In the play, Hall develops remarkable offstage characters who play a major part in determining the onstage action. The play introduces wives, mothers, and children who inhabit the world outside the Glidestone office. Yet they loom over the life of the play. The employees in the house try hard to reduce the cost but get frustrated with their own inefficiency. They are so reluctant to work that they do not bother to read the office circular and end up placing wrong order. In an effort to buy cheaper calculators, the employees order them from Japan, but at the end of the play, it transpires that they could have bought the calculators more cheaply at a local store. They have no desire to improve their performance at workplace. All presentation of this dull repetitive is suggestive of the fact that nothing will ever change in this slothful world. Hall's presentation of the government department does reflect reality, and since he does not provide a name to the department, the play stands for all the government departments of the Nesiland. Glidestone reception and responses. The play was staged by Circa Theatre and was an immediate hit. Even before the prominent dailies like the Evening Post, the Dominion could review it, the theater hall was full and enthusiasts could hardly find a seat. Ross Jolly, an actor who played the character of John, remembered the deafening applause that greeted the end of the first night. At one point, the show had a waiting list of tickets more than 1,000 names long. The play was a huge success because the viewers could easily relate to the characters and plot. Hall was himself a part of the public service, had realistically depicted the lives of the public servants in an affectionate way. The audience never lost sympathy for the characters. They all knew the life that they saw, were themselves a part of it. The play made Circa Theatre a big name, and the actors suddenly became national celebrities. The reviews about the play included the admiration for a mixture of comedy and pathos in the play. It is through Glidestone that Roger Hall establishes his cultural identity of a Pakeha playwright in New Zealand. He captures the sensibilities and experiences of individuals that are quintessentially local. The theme of the play, the characters are very much a part of Wellington, with whom every Pakeha in New Zealand in public service can relate. His ability to portray realistically the essence of local Wellington highlights the fact that he has himself shed his English identity and have emerged as a Pakeha himself, naturalized by his everyday lived experience in New Zealand. Now let us summarize the module. Therefore, in this module, we have learned the basic characteristics of Pakeha plays, basing them on the experience of being a Pakeha and the identity crisis that they suffer from for being outsiders. Since a fair-skinned New Zealander becomes a Pakeha as a result of the lived experience in New Zealand, one of the major characteristics of the Pakeha plays is the way a Pakeha deals with the otherness and try to be a part of Aotearoa by laying a claim on the landscape which provide them an ownership over the space which they inhabit. Thus, most of the Pakeha plays try to situate them within a socio-political and economical space which is quintessentially of New Zealand. So, The following section of the module focused on the play Glide Time, which is Roger Hall's first theatrical breakthrough and an all-time hit. The module discussed the middle-class mundane life and monotony and the angst and exacerbations with a blend of humor and pathos. For further reading, you can consult the reference list and the links provided here, and the further reading list also you can consult. And for self-assessment, you can find the self-assessment file attached here. Thank you.